Everyone. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Saturday Morning Bible Study. My name is Minister Joanne Fair, and I'm here to bring you the word in 30 minutes or less. How is everyone this morning? I hope you're doing well. I'm sorry I was not here for you last Saturday. I was in San Francisco and it just didn't happen. But I usually warn you, but I didn't do that this time. But thank you for tuning in and trusting me again for another Saturday morning. I'm going to continue our talk in 1 Corinthians, but it's kind of funny. As I was studying this lesson, and it's obvious what this lesson should be about, but usually my practice is to read through the scriptures and then just kind of leave it alone, and I wait for God to tell me what does he want me to talk about. And so I'm standing in front of the bathroom mirror and he says perfectionism, and I'm looking at these scriptures and I'm thinking perfectionism. And you know, I continue to study that day and I said, well, you know, I'm just going to do this, you know. And so this morning when I woke up, first thing in my brain when I woke up was perfectionism. So I'm being obedient, and perfectionism is what it's going to be. But it does fit in, and I think that you'll be blessed. So if you have anybody in your life, if you are dealing with this issue of trying to be perfect all the time, then this is the lesson for you. So let me open this up with a word of prayer and we'll get into it. Father God, I just thank you and praise you for who you are, Lord God. I thank you and praise you that you give us everything we need, Lord God. I thank you that you can see inside us, and you know us, and you know what we need, Lord God. So we thank you, Father God, for the lesson that's about to be presented this morning. I thank you for blessing it, Lord God. Use me. I am your vessel, Lord God. If this is for anybody that's watching, Father God, I want you to give them the revelation that they need to connect them with what you're about to say this morning. And all these things I ask in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so let me read. I'm reading from 1 Corinthians, 3rd chapter, verses 5 through 8. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believed, as the Lord gave to each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. So what Paul is talking about here, he's still talking to the Corinthians who were kind of wild, and they were lifting up Paul, lifting up Apollos, and you know, they had pride in these men. They had put all their stock in these men. But Paul is telling them that we are just ministers of God, and we are only the ones that introduced you to the concept. We are the ministers through whom you believe, as the Lord gave each one. So he says, as God gave you to us, we poured into you, and based on what God did through us, you believed. Okay, so he broke it down because it was an agricultural area, and he used this analogy for the people. They understood how plants grew. So he said, I planted the seed, Apollos came behind me and watered the seed, but God is the thing that caused it to grow. So he said that just because I planted, it's no big deal. Just because Apollos watered, no big deal, but God gave the increase. And he says, now he who plants and he who waters are one, meaning it's the same thing, it's God working through each one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. So we all have a part in this. There's things that we do, we're going to be rewarded for the part that we played in it. But it doesn't say anything about that I have to be the one to preach the word to you, and I have to be the one to water that word in you, and I have to be the one to have the increase in you. That's not what it means. But where perfectionism comes in here, and I'm going to revisit this scripture next Saturday with another viewpoint. But today, What God wants us to know here is that in this Christian walk, what we're doing, whether we are pastors of a church, whether we run Bible studies, whatever, we're working in missionary outreach, whatever our role is in the church, we don't have to do it all. We are part of a team, right? So people that don't want to work with anybody, they want to do the planting, the watering, and they think they're giving the increase too. But this issue of I can't do it. I mean, if I don't do it, it's not done right. Or if I'm not there, it's not going to happen. That is false. And that is falling into this issue of being perfect all the time and striving to, just to thinking that you have to do it. But, perfectionism is a spiritual bondage that you can find yourself in. We all know the truth in these sayings that we neglect to do. Well, let me start again. Sometimes with perfectionism, well, I know that perfectionism is based in fear, is based in anxiety. And sometimes if we feel we cannot do it right, we don't do anything at all. So you see that if you're working in the kingdom building aspect of this Christian walk, and you think that only you can do it, or only you can do it perfectly, you're probably not gonna do it at all because you're afraid that you can't do it. And you can see it all the time in companies that when people have an assignment, they work on a committee, they have an assignment or something, and they can't carry it out because they're dealing with this perfectionism and they want it to be an ideal outcome, and it cannot be an ideal outcome. They think that it's on them. It's a very self-reflective issue that you think that only you can do it right. All right. Now, being a perfectionist is different than working in excellence. I can pursue excellence in everything that I do for God, but perfectionism is another issue. Okay. Perfectionism says, well, I can't go online unless I have my house decorated in a certain way and everything got to be perfect in the background behind me, or I'm not dressed right to do it, So now I can't work for God because I'm based on my own self-reliance, all right? So, working for excellence and being a perfectionist is two different things, okay? But perfectionism, as I said before, is a pride or fear-based compulsion that either fuels our obsessive fixation on doing something perfectly or paralyzes us from doing anything at all. So what is behind that? It's true that, people that have anxiety will always try to project this ish this mask of perfection, all right? But perfection always, or almost always, has roots in our desire to be accepted. It has roots in fear. It has roots for being rejected. Maybe you were rejected at some point in your life, and so because of that, you're working to make something perfect, but perfection cannot be achieved. So you're working, you're tired, you have migraine headaches. Why? Because you're trying to do something that does not exist, okay? So it is a common to man temptation that we all face, in our fight against sin. And the wonderful news is that God wants us to live in freedom and not from its tyrannical fear of anxiety and trying to achieve perfection. All right? Now, although in Matthew 5:8, Jesus says, you must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. And it sure sounds like he's asking us to be perfect, right? But Jesus' death on the cross, in God's eyes, was all the perfection that we needed. So that's the foundation that we have to walk on. We have to walk on the fact that Jesus thought so, loved us. I almost said thought so much of us, but that's not it. He loved us so much that he gave us life for us. And that is the perfection that we need, okay? So he says that, in his Sermon on the Mount, he made this statement as the impossible culmination of the fallen, impossible standards of what it means to not sin in anger, lust, divorce, swearing, oaths, and retaliation, as well as what it means to love our enemies. And just before he launches into the perfection section of the sermon, he gives us a clue as to what this means. He says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the prophets, and I have not come to abolish them, but I've come to fulfill them." And you can find that in Matthew 5:17. So Jesus came to perfectly fulfill on our behalf God's demand for us on perfection. So Jesus did it. So that's why in the New Testament, authors write things like, "By a single offering, Jesus has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified." And you can find that in Hebrews 4:10. And there is the key to what Jesus meant about perfection. And the key to our liberation from the tyranny of perfectionism, it's already begun. So because Jesus perfectly lived and died and rose again already, he purchased our perfection. And God the Father, though not unaware of the remaining sin that contaminates everything we do, he sees us perfectly righteous in Jesus. And so in God's eyes, we have been perfected by the virtue of being joined to Jesus by faith, which frees us up from needing to learn to earn his or anybody else's approval through perfectionism. So we're free to engage imperfectly in our fight against sin. So that is so freeing if that is your issue, thinking that you have to do everything right. And not only are you trying to do everything right, you are you're passing this on to your children. You're driving the people you work with, the people you're married to, crazy by trying to achieve this perfection all the time. And it's already been done. So can you see how Satan has trapped us in this cycle of anxiety and fear and trying to be perfect? We can do it all. We hear it all the time, especially with women. You know, we think we can do it all. We can have a job, we can have our children, we could be in this marriage. Everything is done right, and we kill ourselves trying to project this vision of perfectionism as if we have it all together. But the sad part about it is we don't realize it's already been done. That Jesus did that thing for us. So now I can relax. I am as perfect as I'm gonna get. When God looks at me, I'm perfect. I'm everything that I'm supposed to be through Jesus Christ. And that's the issue a lot of times with sin, that we're trying to operate outside of what God has already done for us. We're trying to work up into that feeling of, "I've done it right." No, you were already, if you have faith in Jesus Christ, you have already done it right. All throughout the Bible, there are, people in the Bible and in the history of the Bible, there are people that are imperfect. But nowhere in the Bible does it encourage us towards perfectionism. It promises us perfection. You know, imputed perfection now and perfect and future prediction in the age to come as a free gift of God's grace, so that we will be free of perfectionism. God wants us to be free enough to operate in love. And it is through this love that we draw other people to the gospel. But if we are, you know, putting up impossible standards for people to reach, you know, do this, wear this, go here, do that. If we do all of that trying to achieve this perfection in our Christian walk, well, it's a waste of our time. It's already been done. Look at all of the heroes in the Bible, Abraham, Moses, Hagar, who was a prostitute, Aaron, you know, and his golden calf disaster, David, the Christ-like king, and his Bathsheba affair. Everybody had issues. So why do you think that you're not going to? Sometimes I wonder why God uses me when my life is so imperfect at times. But just understanding this, that Join the crowd. We all got issues. Nobody walks this walk perfectly. And sometimes we have issues up until we meet Christ in our death, you know, up until that time. But God still uses us. He knows our perfectionistic temptations and tendencies. So he gives us stories in the Bible of people that have the same issues to let us know, it's okay, brother. It's okay, sister. You are part of a great group of people that I love. They had issues too. So, you know, we have to learn how to live free from this issue of perfectionism. You know, God has something far better for us to strive towards than our idealized imaginations of perfection, which only end up enslaving us. If we feel that, oh, I only can go out the house if I look this way, if I can't go to church because I don't have nothing good to wear, you know, or I can't wear the same outfit to church twice in 1 month. All of these things that we put ourselves through, when really God is just wanting us to show up. He just says, show up and love the people. That's all I'm asking you to do. Everything else has been done. You can't add anything to the table. You have nothing that I need in order to fulfill what I want to do on this earth. I just need you. I just need you to love my people. That's what I need. You know, and perfectionism is very subtle. Remember, I told you there is a line between excellence and there's a line between perfectionism. Example, excellence is me preparing the Bible study. Excellence is me understanding what my assignment is. That's the excellent part. But perfectionism is, oh, I have to do all these graphics and I have to have this certain outfit on in order to do it. You know, I mean, I'm just being present and doing what God wants me to do. And also, perfectionism is a self-orientation, thinking that this cannot go forth if I don't do it. All right? I can't do it, you know, unless everything is in perfect in line. The people I'm working with, they got to do what's right. You know, I just walk and know that God's going to take care of the rest. I launched our church launched a Bible study this past week on Thursday nights, and I'm honored that God has chosen me to lead this study at this church. And you know, I don't really have a team yet, a full team, but I didn't worry about it. I showed up Thursday night armed with the Word of God, and I said, Lord, this is your program. I know you're going to handle it. But I can remember a time when I would have been so anxious about it and so worried about, well, who's going to be there? But I didn't do that. And it was wonderful. Two people ended up getting delivered. It was an amazing experience, but I had the freedom to just do what God told me to do, to teach and love the people. That's all my only job, you know. So if you're dealing with perfectionism, you're making it about you. And the issue is you're trying to get people to accept you. You're trying to earn your street credit in the Christian walk, and you can't do it because all of your credit has already been given to you through Jesus Christ, all right? So, in other words, perfectionism, even in the battle of sin, is not motivated by faith or love. And Romans 14:23 says, whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. So if you're working and you're not depending on God to do it for you, then it is sin. Perfectionism is sin. And God wants us to be free. We are to be free people. You know, God is looking for love and faith and knowing that we will be imperfect in our walk. No matter how much we grow, we are going to make mistakes. All right? But we are free to fight imperfectly. God is calling us to the wonderful, refreshing experience of getting our eyes off ourselves and how we're measuring up and on to Jesus. Hebrews 12:2 says this, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and he has sat down at the right hand of the Father. So it is done. He wants us to stop pursuing perfectionism or being paralyzed so we are free to pursue love. That's what we pursue. That's what we need to pursue. And so if perfectionism has a inordinate influence on us, God will mercifully design circumstances to defeat our best efforts to fight sin successfully until we learn where our perfectionism comes from. So it is a ponderous weight, a gigantic weight that we have to lay aside in the race of faith. Hebrews 12:1. God does not want us to focus on performing perfectly. He wants us to focus on living out a childlike, dependent faith through authentic acts of love. And that's it. It is about love. So lay aside that heavy weight of trying to be who people want you to be. Get off of that, off of your soapbox about talking about what other people are not doing and how they're not doing it well, and learn to accept who you are the way that God accepts who you are. Do your best. Pursue excellence in this walk. Jesus died on the cross for my sins. So the least I can do is show up as good as I can. But I'm depending through faith on God to make the increase. So like Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, and God provided the increase. And that's my job. I mean, Paul is saying, my job was to drop the seed in the ground. I'm out. Apollo's job was to come behind Paul and water that ground, water that plant. But who actually made that seed come up? God did. And every job you're working on in your church, every committee that you're on, everything, you are a team. And you have to stop thinking that you are the only one that can make this happen. Remember, we have nothing to bring to the table in this walk. And this lesson can carry over to your school. It can carry over to your job, understanding that you are part of the team. It's a freedom. So I just delivered some people today. I just gave you your key to freedom today. So we have to take heed to this because it really is sin. Perfectionism is sin. And I should know, I lived through it forever, and I'm just really now getting free of it, And maybe, they say it comes with age, but no. I think that God has shown me enough that although I try to do things perfectly, that it's about me. That's when I'm making it about me. And it's not about me. It has nothing to do with me. If I wasn't on here talking to you about it, somebody else would be on here talking to you about it. I'm doing my part and I'm staying in my lane. So you get like that. All right? That's all I have for you. Next week, we will come back to that same set of scripture and talk about it some more, but not through the lens of perfectionism. All right. I thank you for tuning in and I will see you next week. If you are in the LA area, Thursday nights at 7 p.m., I have a women's Bible study at 7516 Central Avenue in Los Angeles. It's based through my church, Center of Hope, where my pastor is Jeremy Dixon, and I would love to have you. It's going to be wonderful because God is doing the work. All right, hopefully I'll see you there if you're in the LA area. So Father God, I just thank you and praise you for who you are. I thank you and praise you for giving us the freedom from perfectionism. Lord, I don't even know how I dared to second guess what you told me to do, and just being obedient is just so much better than having my own way. Lord God, everybody that's watching today, Lord God, I lift them up, Lord God. You know who it is, Lord God. Work in their lives. Give them the revelation they need, Lord God. Free them from their dealings with perfectionism, Lord God. So as we get ready to start our Saturday morning, Lord God, I just ask you to put somebody in our path that we can speak a word to. And Lord God, put somebody in our path to speak a word to us as well. We thank you for this lesson. We bless this lesson and we sanctify it in your name, Father God. All these things I ask in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I will see you all later next week. Bye-bye.